Less than 100 years ago, the Soviet Union was mourning the death of Vladimir Lenin. He died so suddenly that the Central Committee of the Communist Party was rife with speculations that Lenin had been poisoned. But who did it? Who would want to kill the leader of the revolution? Lenin personally had answered this question. Before he died, he made a will with two recommendations. To dismiss Stalin from the position of Secretary General for his cruelty. And to appoint Leon Trotsky as Lenin's successor because he had accomplished the October Revolution. But the public at large had no idea about his will. Stalin had classified this sensational document. And then he started a hunt for the man who would have been the leader of the Soviet Union after Lenin. He was crying. Tears were smudging the ink as his trembling hand wrote, "Poor, poor Leon." This jaded 60-year-old man was once the most popular person in the Soviet Union. The right hand of Lenin, the organizer of the October Revolution, the leader of the Red Army, and the main enemy of Stalin. Leon Trotsky spent the last years of his life in exile in Mexico. One day, he heard that his eldest son, Leon, had died during an operation for appendicitis in Paris. Leon was Trotsky's only hope, his last child. After his death, only Trotsky and his wife were still alive. His daughter Zina had committed suicide. She had gassed herself in a hotel room in Germany to avoid being tortured by the Soviet intelligence agency. His other daughter Nina died of pulmonary tuberculosis. Nina's children were shot. The youngest son of Trotsky was killed in Moscow. More than 100,000 people who were or might be acquainted with Trotsky were destroyed. All his friends and relatives, sisters and brothers, were killed on Stalin's order. Trotsky's mother's grave, located in the little village of Yanovka, was demolished. And his last son, Leon, was killed too. Trotsky didn't believe it was due to medical complications. He felt sure that his son had been killed, and he knew that he would be next. He wiped away his tears, determined not to be frightened anymore. He left quite a legacy in the Soviet Union, such as the five-pointed red star. The broadcloth helmet, Budenovka, was also created by Trotsky, who was inspired by the Kiev Rus helmet. He wrote the Oath of Allegiance for Soviet soldiers, the Order of the Red Flag, and the Hammer and Sickle. The Red Army was also his brainchild. The era of Trotsky lasted only 10 years in the Soviet Union, from 1917 to 1927. Stalin then declared him a devil and a traitor, forbade all mentions of him, and ordered to delete him from photos and textbooks. Stalin then began to kill his children one by one. But he hadn't been able to intimidate Trotsky. Even a few thousand kilometers away from Stalin, Trotsky knew something that nobody else knew. He knew that Stalin had poisoned Lenin. Mexico, 1937. In these exclusive shots, you can see the disgraced Leon Trotsky, who had arrived in Mexico, where he would live the last 3 years of his life. Here in Mexico, his friends, famous painter Diego Rivera, and his wife Frida Kahlo met with him. They invited Leon Davidovich Trotsky into their house, hired an armed guard, and made every effort to save him from potential killers. But their hospitality was short-lived. You can see how Leon Davidovich is admiring the mistress of the house. He seems a bit confused and shy. He and Frida have a 30-year age gap. She's a talented painter. He, an old revolutionary on the run. But the age difference couldn't stop their intense feelings. Frida wondered how such a peaceful old man could organize and lead the revolution in Russia. But once Trotsky started speaking, Frida felt his magnetic power. He radiated a superhuman force. Listening to the old revolutionary, Frida felt an uncontrollable attraction. Her Latin temperament forced her to make a move. At the dinner table, Frida whispered "my love" in his ear. The next day, she openly handed over a book containing a passionate love letter. At supper, she stroked his knee under the table. Leon Davidovich was overcome, but then realized that his wife Natalia had seen everything. He was confused and decided to turn it all into a joke. He clasped Frida during a dance and winked at his wife, but he didn't notice that he was getting lost in his own game. The house was silent. Trotsky was working in the office. Suddenly, the door opened, startling him. Frida locked the door on the inside, came up to Trotsky, and unfastened her dress. She whispered lustfully, "Take," but Trotsky didn't allow her to finish her sentence. At the same time, a few thousand kilometers away from Mexico, two men arrived at Stalin's office in the Kremlin. Their names were Lavrenty Beria and Nikolai Yezhov. Stalin nervously rubbed at his diseased hands. A newsletter lay on his table. The foreign newspaper was published by Trotsky, forecasting the future in which Stalin and Hitler would be fighting partners and that Hitler would prevail. Beria and Yezhov understood that they had to stop playing around and kill Trotsky at any cost. So Operation, codenamed Duck, was set into plan. That night, while Frida was whispering passionate words about his incredible force and power, Trotsky's mind was on other things. He was thinking about himself, Leon Bronstein, as a little 8-year-old boy living in the village of Yanovka in the Kherson province of the Russian Empire. He was a quiet and dreamy child until he saw what appeared to be an insignificant country incident. That day, Leon's father, a rich landowner named David Bronstein, carried out some rough justice. He confiscated a peasant's cow that had been grazing on his field. The cow's owner entreated the landowner to return his cow, accusing David of extortion. An enraged Bronstein raised his whip, but froze. His frightened son Leon was staring at him in shock over a nearby fence. In the child's eyes, David, who had been so kind and fair, suddenly resembled a wild animal capable of murder. Back home, the boy became hysterical. He was shocked by how cruel people could be. The future mastermind of the October Revolution had just grasped the inequality of human life and realized he was one of the privileged. At the time, David Bronstein was considered a millionaire. He had more than 20,000 acres in Kherson province, a factory, a windmill, and ponds full of fish. He worked hard, saved money for his business, and expected his children to follow in his footsteps. He hoped his eldest son would become a steward and his youngest son a mechanic. But soon, everybody realized that Leon would be a troublemaker. After the cow incident, Leon kept a low profile. He read profusely, especially biographies of great warlords such as Alexander of Macedon, Julius Caesar, and Napoleon. He subconsciously compared them to his cruel and prosaic father, and he was disappointed. Leon decided to be different. He would never be money-grasping or be cruel to poor children. On the contrary, he would be kind and noble. Something was festering in his mind, and soon a row erupted. One day, David Bronstein angrily had some beggars removed from his yard. Leon then handed them some eclairs over the fence. Maybe this incident would have gone unnoticed if the father hadn't found the empty plate on the ground. David was sure that Leon was pretending to be Robin Hood. The father called his youngest son and berated him for his charity. Leon sulked. But when he noticed that his father was in a fury, he became frightened. He denied it was him and burst into tears. He felt ashamed of his lie and weakness. But Leon couldn't bring himself to speak the truth. David knew that Leon was lying to his face. David decided his son needed to go away and forget about his benign tendencies. So 9-year-old Leon Bronstein was sent to Odessa, where he was enrolled at a German school. His life changed. He suffered an acute attack in the yard. What terrible diagnosis turned Leon Bronstein into the revolutionary demon? Crime and punishment on the lesson of French. How to organize a revolution with help of ordinary beans. That day in the gym, some boys fought to see who was stronger. They screamed, "Go, Leon, go!" He jumped up and pulled himself together. Suddenly, everything went dark as pain filled his chest, making it impossible to breathe. He couldn't remember a thing. When he regained consciousness, back in his room, something wasn't right. The boy became scared when he found out what had happened. The illness that had caused the attack remained a mystery. People thought the sufferers were possessed, but it was epilepsy. What would become of him? How could he bear the caustic comments from people? He felt like a leper. Nobody knew anything about his illness, so he went to the library. In the library, he unveiled an exciting secret. In a medical guide, Leon read that epilepsy was an illness that afflicted geniuses. When he read the names of fellow sufferers, his heart leapt with joy. They included Julius Caesar, Alexander of Macedon, Napoleon, Peter the Great. Leon assumed their greatness was down to the illness. He was convinced that he must be bound for greatness. This discovery became his big secret. After his epilepsy attack, school children jeered him. They called him the epileptic. But Leon took no notice. He thought these fools should feel proud to know Bronstein the genius. Leon became self-reliant. This self-reliance soon passed to other children. Soon they stopped teasing him. Leon became top of the class at school and would help less able students. He protected younger students and began to learn how to make inspirational speeches. Soon, Leon became the leader of the class. He was happy to be the leader, as he knew that one day his name would go down in history. At the time, Leon didn't realize that fame was often short-lived. But soon, a tough lesson would wound his pride and turn the best student of the class into an outcast. Next up, Leon encourages the class of students to start howling quietly and monotonously. The French teacher is unable to find the culprit. Leon is laughing to himself with satisfaction. But the day after, his punishment is announced. He was expelled from his school, and his French teacher said that Leon Bronstein was a morally depraved person. The boy believed that it was true until he met a prison guard called Trotsky. This meeting would turn Bronstein into a monster and help him change his fate forever. The revolution would become Leon's birthday present to himself. At the end of the 19th century, schools were stern institutions. The students had to be obedient and disciplined. In class, they had to sit quietly with their hands in front of them. Leon's school was no exception. He suggested to his friends that they punish a teacher. The reason was a noble one. During a French lesson, the unpopular teacher offended one of the students. The teacher laughed at him and unfairly gave him a mark F. The class was indignant. The high achiever Leon Bronstein made an outcry against petty tyranny. But words were not enough. Leon wanted to take revenge, and so he made a foolproof plan. During the next lesson, when the teacher turned his back to the class, Leon signaled to the other students to start howling quietly and monotonously. The teacher turned. Everyone became silent. But when he turned to the blackboard, the terrible sound began again, driving him crazy. The students carried on all through the class, reducing the French teacher to tears. In despair, he ran out of the room. The students had triumphed. Leon was proud of himself. Though he hadn't exactly led an army or conquered the world, the die had been cast. The next day, the teacher complained to the headmaster and an investigation began. The school management demanded that the perpetrator come forward, otherwise all would be punished. But Leon refused to own up, so the school headmaster punished 15 innocent students. Leon was not among them, because he'd been top of the class. The innocent students hoped that Leon would own up. But instead, he packed his things and went home. His friends felt betrayed and told the teacher who the real culprit was. The school head was amazed. How could such a diligent boy be so two-faced? Leon didn't know that he'd been betrayed, but he slept badly that night. He felt remorse. It had been his idea. He had to take responsibility for the incident, tell the truth, and proudly suffer the punishment. But he was too weak and afraid to tell the truth. A new thought crossed his mind the following morning. He hoped the incident would have been forgotten about, as he assumed his friends would be loyal to their leader. Leon was deep in thought when the French teacher grasped him by the arm, fixed him with a look of contempt, and said, "The best pupil in the second form is a morally depraved person." The future revolutionary Leon Trotsky would remember that day for the rest of his life. A trial was arranged at the school. All his friends had betrayed him. The teacher scolded him for his heartlessness. 10-year-old Leon was expelled from the school. He had learnt two important lessons from this incident. Firstly, the leader should always take responsibility for his actions. Secondly, you shouldn't waste your talents when you have such an important mission ahead. A year later, Leon returned to school, but he had changed. He behaved well and was secretly training to become a public speaker. He read a lot of books, but had no friends. On graduating from the school, young Bronstein moved from Odessa to Mykolaiv, where he found people he could relate to. Mykolaiv, 1896. An old worker at a secret meeting took some beans from his pocket and demonstrated to young Bronstein the meaning of revolution. He said, "There is a Tsar, ministers, bishops, and generals. And there are noble and merchant classes. And this pile of beans is the common people." Leon looked at the mixed beans, and he understood his mission. He didn't want to be a bean, but the hand that controlled the beans. He would rouse people all over the world, and he knew how. He would cause a revolution that would make the empire of Alexander of Macedon seem like nothing. Leon was ecstatic. The coming revolution excited all the young people of his age. In the euphoria of his plans, he didn't notice a woman who couldn't take her eyes off him. Next up, the unknown women of Leon Trotsky. Why did he leave his wife and two children in Siberia? Fear and loathing in Lenin's milieu. How Trotsky had neglected an opportunity to place himself at the head of the Soviet Union. Alessandra Sokolovskaya feasted her eyes upon a new member of their underground organization. They had a 7-year age gap. Sasha was an old-time revolutionary. Leon understood that this woman could be his trump card when she introduced him to the highest members of the underground movement. She was his first stage to glory. Leon was flattered at her love and devotion. Soon they became lovers. When Alessandra became pregnant, Leon lost his mind. He felt responsible, but he hadn't planned on marrying Alessandra. Should he marry her or not? The dilemma was answered when somebody reported the underground movement to the police and all its members were imprisoned. At this point, Bronstein got married to Sokolovskaya. After a lengthy investigation, sentence was finally passed. Leon was to be exiled to Siberia. By then, he already had a child. His daughter Zina was born in prison. Soon, Sokolovskaya became pregnant for the second time. 20-year-old Leon Bronstein became the father of the two daughters. He was worried that he might have to stay in exile for many years. He knew he could become a good father and husband. But before he went to Siberia, he met a person who changed his plans and views on life. It was Trotsky, the prison guard. The prison cell was wet, filled with thieves and political prisoners. Here was Homo homini lupus est. If you turned away, you'd be eaten. But only one person kept the discipline in the prison. The chief prison guard, Trotsky. He was an authoritarian and a cruel man who had in his control all prisoners, other guards, and even the prison governor. Here was an ideal leader. The overlord of the prison amazed young Leon Bronstein. Looking at the prison guard, he understood how a real leader had to be, exacting, pitiless and self-confident. Only this way would everybody submit to his commands. Even in exile, Leon was unable to banish Trotsky from his mind. It was unbearable to think he would spend his best years there. The great mission of world transformation was waiting for him. He wrote articles about the necessity for major changes in society. Leon secretly passed these articles abroad. Another exile emigrant, Vladimir Ulyanov Lenin, took notice of the young, talented political writer. He asked Bronstein to visit. Leon started to prepare for the journey. Fellow members raised funds and made him a new passport. Leon gave himself a new surname, Trotsky. His wife cried, but let him go. She tied several sheets and pillows together and placed them under a blanket to look like a body. When the guards noticed that Bronstein wasn't around, she told them that he was ill in bed and to not disturb him. Alessandra made sure their children knew about his efforts. She outlived both her daughters, who ended up being killed on Stalin's orders because of their father's deeds. She loved Trotsky unconditionally. Leon Trotsky seldom thought about his wife and children. He was wrapped up in himself. Leon met Lenin and became his personal assistant. He began writing articles for the newspaper Spark and enjoyed a happy and free life on party expenses. In Paris, he met a beautiful noblewoman, Natalia Sadova, and fell in love with her. They never married, but lived together until their death. Natalia gave birth to two sons and shared his ideals. Both children were killed on Stalin's orders. Even then, Sadova didn't blame her husband. Mexico, 1937. He never seemed to grow old. Even at the age of 58, his eyes still shone and voice rang out. Frida Kahlo was thrilled that her affair had become so much more. She'd been entranced by Trotsky, just like so many women before. Like the sculptor Claire Sheridan, who after the October Revolution came to Moscow to sculpt a bust of the revolution's hero. While the rest of Moscow was gossiping about their love affair, his wife pretended not to notice. Larissa Reisner was also his lover, meeting him during the Russian Civil War and glorifying him in her poems. Natalia Sadova bore this too. She knew what a philanderer her husband was. Natalia understood that they would be together despite everything. She had been his lover, wife, accomplice, and friend. But this time, Natalia rebelled against her husband's romance with a married woman who was 30 years younger than him. She didn't make a scene, but simply told her husband, "I can't bear it any longer." Leon Davidovich panicked. He told her he was devoted to her, calling himself her faithful dog and writing affectionate and erotic letters. He eventually broke off relationships with Frida. Natalia forgave him for everything yet again, but Frida's husband couldn't bear her unfaithfulness. Diego forced Trotsky to leave their house and divorced Frida when he found out about their affair. The proof of Trotsky's final passion was a self-portrait that Frida dedicated to her famous lover. The unpopular couple were forced to move to the Mexico City suburbs, where time flew by. In July 1939, Stalin was informed of the progress of Operation Duck. He received a list of possible ways of assassinating Trotsky, including poisoning, car or house bomb, stabbing in the back, headshot, strangulation, or even armed attack. Stalin approved all these methods and allotted $300,000 to achieve an outcome. In August 1939, a suspicious man appeared with a packet near Trotsky's house. The man ran away when the guards appeared. An unexploded device was found. Trotsky was horrified. He realized Stalin would never rest until he'd killed him. He remembered how the cruel confrontation had started. In 1905, the Party Congress was held in Finland. Trotsky was the hero of the Congress, overshadowing even Lenin's fame. Later that year, the Russian Revolution began. A few weeks later, he became the leader of this spontaneous revolution. He was at the forefront of the workers' rebellion and became a member of the Soviet Petrograd. When the revolution was crushed, Trotsky was sent to prison and made an impassioned speech in court. The court exiled him to Siberia for life. But Trotsky escaped and came to the border on a reindeer. In the Congress, Leon was at the height of his fame. He had almost achieved victory. The whole of Petrograd listened intently to him. The crowds were applauding. One young member of the party, unknown to Trotsky, looked on enviously. It was Koba, a dark-haired comrade from Georgia. He was not an eloquent follower of Marxism. He didn't start revolutions. Nobody in the party took him seriously. During the break, Koba approached Trotsky, who was already surrounded by admirers, and shook his hand to congratulate him. But the hero of the day didn't notice Yosef Dzhugashvili's timid gesture. The future Secretary General couldn't bear this humiliation. Later, during the revolution, they would officially meet. But Trotsky never treated Stalin with any respect. He laughed at his accent and his stiff bureaucratic ways. Trotsky, now in Mexico, being chased by Stalin, tried to remember when it all went wrong. How this boring Georgian had become such an indispensable assistant to Lenin. How did he seize Lenin's power? How could he commit such a crime as poisoning Lenin? In 1940, Trotsky's Uber Borgia article was published in the Kremlin, suggesting that Stalin had poisoned Lenin. Though the article was only speculative, Stalin became hysterical and ordered Beria to start Operation Duck immediately. On the night of the 23rd-24th of May 1940, a group of terrorists fired at the house where Trotsky had been hiding. Trotsky miraculously survived after his wife pushed him off the bed and threw herself on top of him. The gunmen never found them. That night, Leon Davidovich had another epilepsy attack. Natalia held him while he shook. During his blackout, he felt as though he was traveling through time back to Russia. The night of the 24th-25th of October 1917, more than 20 years earlier, had been the illustrious night of the October Revolution, which had made Trotsky famous. That same night at 11 p.m, armed soldiers and seamen were moving quickly and quietly through the streets of St. Petersburg. Trotsky led them through the city center. He scheduled the seizure of important strategic objects personally. The soldiers under his instructions had occupied train stations, the National Bank, telephone exchanges, and power plants. Even the last fortress of the Russian provincial government, the Winter Palace, was seized. By dawn, the whole city was controlled by the Bolsheviks. Nobody knew, but that night was also his 38th birthday. The October Revolution had been his birthday present to himself. Lenin had suggested to revolt on October the 27th, but Trotsky insisted on the 25th of October. He had overcome his fate and his weakness, even more so than his father. He had left his old life far behind. He was overwhelmed with joy. Mexico, 1940. Leon Davidovich regained consciousness after the attack was over and the danger had passed. The gunmen had left without taking Trotsky. The old exile knew that they would never make the same mistake again. He was sure that next time they would send not an army, but a single killer who could even be an acquaintance. The danger did in fact come from within when Trotsky's secretary introduced her fiancé Jackson to him. He felt uneasy, but put it down to nerves. The countdown to his death had begun. In 1917, Leon Trotsky had many privileges. He was glorified by the Bolsheviks, co-directed the state with Lenin. He was called the soul of the revolution. During that year, he had created the Red Army. When Leon remembered the prison guard Trotsky, he started liberating the masses from oppression. The elite and intelligentsia should be destroyed in concentration camps. In the army, the death penalty had been reinstated. Soldiers were shot for desertion, for refusal to execute an order, or for concealment of a deserter. Trotsky appointed former commanders, such as Vasily Chapayev, Georgi Zhukov, Konstantin Rokossovsky, Mikhail Chukachevsky, to leading positions within the army of the Russian Empire. He also created the position of commissar, the party's inspector. Trotsky, the father of the Red Army, created an armored train to neutralize any resistance. People called it the Train of Death. Whenever the train appeared, execution would surely follow. Comrade Trotsky would then make an impassioned speech about world revolution and reward the best soldiers with awards engraved with their own names. 2 years passed. The Russian Civil War was over. Trotsky returned to Moscow a hero, where he realized that everything in the Kremlin had changed during his absence. The Politburo had become a solid apparatus. Lenin was ill, and there was no one left to keep the revolution alive. Everyone was keen to know who would succeed Lenin. At the time, Stalin was a prospective Bolshevik and the new Secretary General of the Central Committee. But Trotsky didn't attach any great importance to this. Leon led the powerful army and thought of Stalin as a mere logistics manager. But Leon Davidovich didn't know that during Lenin's illness, the Politburo was in charge. Stalin, as the Secretary General in Politburo, was responsible for a selection of issues. As opposed to the self-confident Trotsky, Stalin was being cautious. He understood that timing was everything. Stalin suggested that Trotsky have a vacation to renew his strength after the exhausting battles of the Russian Civil War and spend time with his family. But this was all part of his devious plan. Trotsky accepted the proposal. He was tired and missed his wife and children. And so he went on holiday to Tiflis. This would be his first and biggest mistake. On arrival at Tiflis, he received a shocking telegram. Vladimir Lenin had died suddenly. Leon Trotsky wanted to come back immediately, but Stalin advised him against it. In his telegram, he wrote, "The funeral will be tomorrow. You will not make it on time. Stay in Tiflis. Don't desert your family." Trotsky made the fatal mistake of remaining in Tiflis. Everyone witnessed an inconsolable Stalin following Lenin's coffin. He initiated a new Soviet parliamentary tradition whereby the person following immediately behind the coffin of the preceding leader would become the new leader himself. When Trotsky returned to Moscow, Stalin was leading the state. When Leon Davidovich returned from holiday, he heard rumors about Lenin's possible poisoning. It was said that the gravely ill Lenin asked Stalin to ease his pain and give him poison. Stalin did as he was told. The party bureaucracies, knowing about Stalin's character, surreptitiously circulated these rumors. Trotsky, irritated by these rumors, asked Stalin directly about the poisoning. Stalin had vehemently refused that he honored Lenin's request. But Trotsky would remember for the rest of his life how Stalin's eyes flashed with anger. Later, while in exile, Leon collated dates, facts about Stalin's actions, information from party comrades, and gathered evidence that Stalin had poisoned Lenin. Because of this, Trotsky's destruction was necessary. At first, he was deprived of his rank and command. Later, he was thrown out of the party and deported. Mexico, 1940. Throughout the 10 years of his exile, Trotsky continually exposed Stalin's wicked regime. While his children, relatives, and acquaintances were all killed in the Soviet Union. The intelligence service had killed his last son, Leon's true follower, during an ordinary appendectomy in Paris. And they would soon murder him. From then on, he woke up every morning appreciating life. 3 months later, their worst nightmare came true. All this time, Trotsky's secretary's fiancée was always around and everybody had grown accustomed to him. On August the 20th, 1940, Jackson arrived at the house dressed in a hat and an overcoat, despite the overpowering heat. Leon Trotsky led his visitor to his office. At that moment, Jackson, who was actually Ramon Makada, a secret agent hired by the Soviet intelligence service, suspiciously closed the door behind him. Trotsky started to worry. He remembered he had a revolver in his desk. He reached into the drawer. Suddenly, Trotsky realized this was the end. Jackson was wielding an ice pick. He brought it down on Trotsky's head. The pain was excruciating. The guards gathered round when they heard him cry out. A blood-spattered Trotsky fell into his wife's arms, whispering, "Natasha, this is the end." He no longer had to write articles or suffer from uncertainty and fear. Trotsky survived for 24 hours. The next day, on August 21st, 1940, all Soviet newspapers announced the news. The man who had been damned by the Soviet Union workers was dead. After the funeral, Natalia Sadova discovered a new article in her husband's documents. Leon Davidovich predicted the start of the Second World War when Germany broke the peace accord with the Soviet Union. He was asking people to prepare for war. At the same time, Stalin ordered the execution of anyone who followed Trotsky's advice. Trotsky's prophecy came true less than a year later. Leon Davidovich had been a strategic genius. He had changed history. But in the end, he became a victim of his own creation, the revolution.